وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله وبعد. So alhamdulillah, inshallah by the grace and help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are resuming studying Sirah inshallah, our study of Sirah, the biography of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us all in knowledge, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for these steps that you have taken to the masjid for salah and also for studying the seerah of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us his love subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the company of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in paradise inshaAllah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us all inshaAllah in the hub inshaAllah with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the shafa'ah, the intercession of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us acting on the teachings of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and following the excellent example of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all inshallah, and bless you all inshallah, and all of our family members inshallah, and take us all inshallah, all our family members inshallah, to his true path inshallah, and enable us all the time to follow his true path subhanahu wa ta'ala, and give guidance to all people inshallah, and accept all of our good deeds inshallah. Allahumma ameen. So before Ramadan, we have finished studying the Ghazwat Badr. And today, inshallah, or tonight, we will start studying Ghazwat Uhud, which took place in the third year of the Hijrah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as you know, in Ghazwat Badr, the Muslims, they didn't like to fight, but they only tried to get back some of their rights that were taken unrightly from them by the disbelievers of Mecca, who took all their possessions when Muslims migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah. The disbelievers of Mecca, the polytheists of Mecca, they prevented Muslims from taking their money with them, and they controlled their businesses and their homes, and they took their money from them unduly, of course. And then the chance came that Muslims were about to meet a caravan for Quraysh, for those same polytheists who have already taken Muslims' possessions in Mecca. So a caravan of Abu Sufyan loading great amounts of commodities was passing near Al-Madinah, and Muslims' plan was just to get back some of their stolen things from those polytheists of Mecca. But then the caravan was able to escape, and Muslims didn't like to fight, but the polytheists, they insisted on calling many people to come from Mecca, a big army to come from Mecca and to fight against Muslims. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported Muslims, and they were the victorious, though they didn't make any preparation for fighting in like a big battle. Their number was about 300 only, and number of the disbelievers was about 1,000. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported Muslims, and they were able to overcome the disbelievers. So the disbelievers now felt that this was a very bad humiliation that they had experienced at the hands of Muslims. This is what they thought. And they thought that they could never leave this unavenged. So they started to prepare for a big battle against Muslims, to get rid of them all, and to also to stop the spread of Islam and to stop Prophet Muhammad from continuing to deliver his message and calling people to Islam. And they were very angry and very furious, but they didn't like this to be known by Muslims, to the extent that they forbade laminating over their dead ones who were killed or murdered in the event of Badr, or the Battle of Badr. And also, they didn't like to ransom any one of the captives that were taken by Muslims in the Battle of Badr, just not to show Muslims that they were very sad and furious because what has happened to them in Badr. And again, they started to prepare for an overall war against Muslims in order to restore back their wounded prestige and pride. And the main enthusiastic ones among the disbelievers who wanted to start this war were Safwan ibn Umayyah, Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'a, and Abu Sufyan ibn Harb, the one who was the owner and the leader of this caravan of Badr. So they started to get support of all other tribes that was living or were living in Mecca. So Quraysh, all those people were from Quraysh. So Quraysh insisted on launching this war against Muslims to destroy them all and to take revenge from what has happened to them in Badr. Though they were the ones who started the fighting in Badr. But anyway, this was Quraysh. And those people, the main ones of Quraysh, started to make agreements with all other tribes that wanted to join the war against Muslims. And not only inside Mecca, but also they spoke to the people living in the suburbs of Mecca as well. And they collected a big number of fighters and warriors in a big army to fight against Muslims in Uhud. Also, they decided that the caravan of Abu Sufyan, which managed to escape in the Badr event and which amounted to 1,000 camels and 50,000 dinars, they decided to use all this money in order to provide this army with more equipments and more weapons to be with them and more preparations to be more and more strong in fighting against Muslims. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Anfal about this, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ لِيَصُدُّوا عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَسَيُنْفِقُونَهَا ثُمَّ تَكُونُ عَلَيْهِمْ حَسْرَةً ثُمَّ يُغْلَبُونَ وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ يُحْشَرُونَ. Indeed, the disbelievers spent their money and their wealth in order to hinder people from the path of Allah. So they will spend it, but it will one day be as a regret for them and a remorse for them. ثُمَّ يُغْلَبُونَ, then they will be defeated. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ يُحْشَرُونَ, and on the day of judgment, the disbelievers will be gathered to be punished in hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told that their plans in the end will be in vain or will be in vain, and that they will feel the regret for whatever they spent against Islam, and that finally also they will be in hellfire. They even hired poets to incite people amongst the Arabs, the non-Muslims, and to encourage them and stir them up and motivate them to fight against Muslims. So they hired a poet called Abu Azza al-Sha'ir. And this poet, he was actually one of the prisoners of war, one of the captives in the event of Badr. But Prophet Muhammad, but he told Prophet Muhammad sallam, Ya Muhammad man lissidya, O Muhammad, if I am here in a prisoner of war, who's going to spend on my little girls? Because he used to have little girls, daughters. So Prophet Muhammad sallam was so generous, and Prophet Muhammad sallam just set him free. With one condition, that he promised Prophet Muhammad ﷺ that he was not going to fight against Muslims again, or even to say any poetry inciting people or motivating people against Muslims. But he was tempted by Safwan ibn Umayyah, one of the big leaders of Quraysh. He tempted him and he told him, if you are the victorious in this battle, then I will give you money until you remain for the whole of your life one of the rich people of Mecca. And if we are defeated, then I will continue spending on and providing for your daughters. So don't worry about your daughters, I will be supporting them financially. So he was tempted by Safwan ibn Umayyah, and he broke his promise with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And of course, we take lesson from this that, you know, when the truth is clear, then we must not allow anybody us to deviate us from the truth. Or when there is right and false. If something is right and we know that it is right, then we should not allow anybody else to tempt us to do what we know that it is wrong. And that also breaking promises is very bad, because as we will come to know that he was killed after the Battle of Uhud, he was killed by Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad ordered that he had to be killed because he betrayed Muslims. So his final consequence was not good, and the fact that Safwan ibn Umayyah tempted him was very harmful for him, and Safwan ibn Umayyah couldn't avail him of anything. And this is like shaitan and ins as well. As you know, that there is difference from like shaitan, that we all know shaitan, hidden shaitan, from jinn, and from an ins, from human beings. So Safwan ibn Umayyah was like one of the shayateen and ins, you know, and he deviated Abu Azza al-Sha'ir, and he broke his promise with the Prophet, and then he was killed by Muslims because of his betrayal to the Muslims and to the Prophet. So salam, and we will come to this inshallah afterwards, inshallah. Also, they hired another poet whose name was Musafi' ibn Abd Manaf al-Jumahi, also to encourage people and to incite the disbelievers to fight against Islam and against Muslims. And also, we learn from this that, you know, a Muslim or any human being must not follow decorated words. And, you know, these decorated words are at many times meant to just to deceive people. So they were just making a false propaganda. So we must not follow or believe in any false propaganda. So, and this is very obvious. They didn't have any good purpose for fighting. And that's why they needed two poets just to say poetry to stir up people and motivate them to fight. Muslims didn't need this, because Muslims, they knew that they were defending a right cause. They didn't need, you know, to have poets just to encourage them. This was not the one of the main incentives leading Muslim to fight at all. But for people who fight for no good purpose or no valid purpose, they need to do this. They need to have their own propaganda via different means. But of course, the a wise person does not follow this, does not follow decorated speech. He just follows the truth. The truth. The truth is clear, but not decorated speech, which is not the truth. This one should be, you know, given up by Muslims, or, you know, don't act on it, of course. Then at the turn of the year, because Ghazwat Badr, or the event of Badr, was in the month of Ramadan, in the second year of Hijrah, migration of Prophet Muhammad to Medina. So at the turn of the year, after 1 year, in Shawwal, the third year of Hijrah, everything was ready. I mean, the disbelievers, by this time, they had finished preparing their army, and they were ready to start their decisive war that they wanted and desired to launch against Muslims, to wage against Muslims, to get rid of them all. And they had a very big army that consisted of 3,000 warriors. So in Badr, their number was only 1,000 warriors, but in Uhud, after 1 year, because they contacted, Quraysh contacted all other tribes inside and outside Mecca and around Mecca. So now their number became 3,000 warriors and 700 arms and 3,000 camels and 200 horses. And 200 horses is a very big number of horses. When we speak about horses, usually number of horses is rather than number of camels, but 200 horses is a big number of, you know, of horses. And they kept the horses unused until they reached the battlefield, until they reached a place very near to Uhud. So from Mecca to Medina, about 500 kilometers, they kept the horses unused, because they, of course, they didn't like to the horses to get exhausted, so that they can use them only in the battlefield in their full strength. And also what they did as well, they decided to take some of their women with them. Yeah, they took 15 women with them, and they said, so that those women would encourage us to fight manfully, so that, you know, when we know that women are behind us, so they keep encouraging us to fight more and more, and to fight courageously and manfully, then this is something good. This is what they thought. And again, also this shows that they didn't have any, of course, they didn't have any true aqidah, or didn't have any true conviction, or they know that they knew that they didn't have any valid purpose for fighting, so they needed all these poets and their women to be behind them, to encourage them, because for Arabs, of course, it was a very bad thing, you know, not to defend one's women or woman. So they did so for sake of getting more shaja'ah, more to be more courageous. Because they didn't depend on Allah, they didn't rely on Allah, of course. And this is totally different from the case with Muslims. Most say, حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ, and they تَوَكَّلْتُ عَلَى اللَّهِ, I rely on Allah, and that's it. But and they don't, their minds are not busy with poets or women to be behind them or anything like this. Okay. So general leadership of the army, of this army of the disbelievers, was for Abu Sufyan ibn Harb. And you know, Abu Sufyan ibn Harb, later on in the 8th year of Hijrah, he became Muslim. Later, like 5 years later. But now, at that time, at the time of Uhud, third year of Hijrah, he was not yet a Muslim. He was the leader of this big army of the disbelievers in Uhud. And leadership of the horsemen was for Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid. And he was at that time not yet Muslim as well. And his assistant was Sayyidina Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl. Because even Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, he also embraced Islam in the 8th year of Hijrah as well. So subhanAllah, so you see how Islam is powerful. This is a proof that Islam is so powerful, because leaders, the very big leaders, the greatest leaders of the disbelievers who were leading all this big army in Uhud, then all of them, they became Muslims. Abu Sufyan, Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid, and Sayyidina Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl. And this shows how Islam is a very powerful religion. Not powerful, I mean by powerful, spiritually powerful religion, because it is the religion calling to all good things and forbidding all bad things, and calling to all good and forbidding all evil. So all those people later on, they understood that Islam is the right thing to be followed, and they became Muslims. And the flag, Ar-Raya, the flag was entrusted to the tribe of Abd Ad-Dar. So they were responsible for carrying the flag of the of this disbelieving army in the battle of Uhud. And then when all these preparations have been completed, the army started to move from Mecca towards Medina, the disbelieving army, of course. And at that time, Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a Muslim, but he was hiding his Islam. And he was living in Mecca. So he kept a watchful eye on all the preparations that were made by the Meccan army. And then when they started moving to Al-Madinah, Prophet Muhammad, radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Al-Abbas, he sent someone to go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Al-Madinah and to tell him about all the details about this army. And this man, he went very quickly and he cut the big distance of 500 kilometers from Mecca to Al-Madinah only in 3 days. And this is a very short period, because he was using a camel or a horse. And he met with Prophet Muhammad sallam in Quba, that Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib, Prophet's uncle, he was a Muslim, he was in Mecca, he knew about all the preparations of the disbelievers, and he sent someone to tell the Prophet ﷺ in Medina about the all the details of the army of the disbelievers. And this man reached Quba and met with the Prophet ﷺ in Quba. And Medina at that time was smaller than this time, so Quba was outside Medina, like on the borders of Medina. So, but he met Prophet Muhammad in Quba, because it happened that Prophet Muhammad was in Quba. And as you know, in the hadith, that it was the habit of Prophet Muhammad to visit Quba Masjid every Saturday, so long as he was able. So maybe this was Allahu A'lam, a Saturday, Allahu A'lam. But it happened that Prophet Muhammad was in the Quba Masjid. So he gave the Prophet Muhammad a letter, and Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b, he is one of the qari's and one of the people who used to write down the wahy for the Prophet Muhammad. He was there with the Prophet Muhammad. So the Prophet gave the letter to, this letter came from Al-Abbas to the Prophet. Prophet gave the letter to Ubay ibn Ka'b. He read the letter to the Prophet Muhammad, and everything was told about the preparations that were taken by this disbelieving army. So Prophet Muhammad sallam commanded Ubay ibn Ka'b to keep this as a secret and not to tell anybody about the very important contents of the letter. And from this also we take a lesson that, of course, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, for example, of course, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, Sayyidina Uthman, all the companions, Allah witnesses for them all in the Noble Quran. So all of them were very, of course, righteous people, are very good examples. But because this was a very critical situation, so Prophet ﷺ asked Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b not to tell anybody about the contents of the letter. Of course, for you know, you can understand this, you can deduct, because this is a very critical situation. And even maybe Prophet Muhammad didn't like that news would go to the Meccans that now everything is known to Muslims. So Prophet didn't like this, so he kept the information only for him and Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hurried to Al-Madinah. And of course, he is a Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, sometimes leaders, if they are outside their countries and they know that a very big army, which is much stronger than their own army, is attacking, they say, okay, we'll stay abroad for some more time to escape. They find a way, somewhere to hide. But of course, this is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He knew that they were 3,000, and he knew that no preparations in Medina at all in the side of Muslims. But of course, he, the Prophet, he went to Al-Madinah, the place that he knew that would be attacked maybe a few days later, and that he was the wanted, the main wanted person at that time by the disbelieving people of Mecca. But he went to Medina. So and this courage, the courage of the prophets and of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he held a meeting. Once he reached Medina, he held sallallahu alaihi wasallam a meeting with the leaders of Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar. Only the leaders of Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar. And he made shura with them. And actually, before the battle started, Prophet Muhammad made shura two times. One time he made it with a small number of only the leaders of the Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar. And this was the first time. And this shura, like consultation, was made just to decide what measures that had to be taken to face this hostility coming against Muslims. And after seeking the opinions of the leaders of Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar, the plan started to be carried out, and all of Al-Madinah was put on the alert, and all men were heavily armed. All men of Al-Madinah were heavily armed, even during the Salah, in anticipation of any emergency. And a group of the, of course, armed helpers, Ansar, they volunteered to guard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And amongst them were Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah, and he was one of the chief leaders of Al-Khazraj, and Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, one of the chief leaders of Al-Aws, and Sayyidina Usayd ibn Hudayr, one of the chief leaders of Al-Aws as well. So those are the Ansar, those are the helpers, those are the people who gave the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam their covenant to defend him and to defend Islam if he was to come to stay in their city. And they fulfilled the pledge, and they met their promise with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they gave these very good examples that the chief leaders of their tribes, the tribes of Al-Ansar, were the nearest persons to the enemy. I mean, they didn't fear, they didn't let, you know, the young men or young, you know, laymen and common people just to be in front of the rows of fighting, and they would be behind so that to be protected. No, they went to the front. They would always go to the front lines, and they would surround Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and guard him not to be subjected to any harm from the side of the disbelievers. And they even used to keep an eye at the door of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the night. So they used to accompany the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and at night when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go home, they would remain awake, keeping an eye at his door, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to guard him, because 3,000 warriors were coming to to attack Medina, which is very, very big sin. Other groups of Muslims, they began to guard the entrances of Al-Madina and the main roads or ways leading to Al-Madina as well, lest they should be taken by surprise. So this was the plan done by the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the group of the leaders of Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar, when Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made shura with them to see what procedures that had to be taken to face this hostility from the side of the disbelievers. On the other hand, the Meccans, they continued marching towards Al-Madina, and they reached Al-Abwa. Al-Abwa is a place very near to Al-Madina, and this was the place where Sayyida Amina bint Wahb was buried. Her grave is there. So Hind bint Utba, wife of Abu Sufyan ibn Harb, the general leader of the non-Muslims army in Uhud, she suggested to dig up the grave of the Prophet's mother, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it seems that obviously that she was, her attitude at that time was very aggressive. Then she embraced Islam as well in the 8th year of Hijrah with her husband Abu Sufyan in the after Fath Mecca. But at that time she was very aggressive because, as you know, and we will come to this later, also she was very aggressive to the Sayyidina Hamza, the Prophet's uncle, in this battle. And before the battle, she liked to dig up the grave of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the people's heart when it does not have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it does not follow true guidance. You know, people, when they are deviated, unfortunately, they can do all bad things. So this lady, at that time, she was not following the truth, not following the true guidance, not guided by the light given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So her harms, you know, were not only directed against alive people, but also to the dead people. She was ready to harm, you know, the dead people. And of course, this was a big harm against Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the leaders of the disbelieving army, they didn't agree. They feared the bad consequence of doing so, of digging up the grave of Sayyida Amina bint Wahb. And of course, they knew that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved him so much, though they were less than them in number, and weaker than them with regard to material preparations like weapons and horses and camels. But they feared them because they knew that if this had happened, then the companions of Prophet ﷺ would not have let it go easily. So, and this is a sign again that Alhamdulillah, Prophet ﷺ was supported by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above all, then by his sincere companions as well. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَيَّدَكَ بِنَصْرِهِ وَبِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Okay. So, they proceeded after that, after Al-Abwa, until they reached a place called Aynayn, and this very near to the Mount Uhud. And when Prophet Muhammad sallam came to know that the disbelievers were very near to Uhud, which is nearly also very near to Al-Madina at that time, the Prophet Muhammad sallam exchanged views with a bigger number of Muslims. So not only the leaders of Al-Muhajirin and Al-Ansar, But he وسلم, included the youth as well. The youth who were a very important part in the Muslims' army. So Prophet ﷺ included them in this shura. And this was the second time Prophet ﷺ did shura before the battle started. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told them about a dream that he had seen, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He told them, إِنِّي قَدْ رَأَيْتُ وَاللَّهِ خَيْرًا. By Allah, I have seen a dream, and I pray that it is a good dream. رَأَيْتُ بَقَرًا يُذْبَحْ. I have seen cows that were slaughtered. وَرَأَيْتُ فِي ذُبَابِ سَيْفِ سُلْمًا. And I have seen that there was a groove, a little cut, at the pointed top of my sword. وَرَأَيْتُ أَنِّي أَدْخَلْتُ يَدِي فِي دِرْعٍ حَصِينًا. And I have seen that I have inserted my hand in a protective armor. And he صلى الله عليه وسلم interpreted this dream for them. So he صلى الله عليه وسلم interpreted the cows that he صلى الله عليه وسلم saw that were slaughtered, that a number of his companions will be killed as martyrs, shuhada, in this battle. And he interpreted the groove that he has seen at the pointed top of his sword, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that one man amongst his own family members or house will be hurt. And he interpreted for them, وَأَدْخَلْتُ يَدِي فِي دِرْعٍ حَصِينَ. I have inserted my hand in a protective armor, that this is Al-Madina. And this is a sign that to be inside Al-Madina was better than fighting outside Al-Madina. And so this was very clear to everybody, made clear by Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. But still, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did the consultation, did the mashura or the shura. He ﷺ suggested that the Muslim army should be inside Al-Madina, and that the disbelieving army would be in the open area, so that they would be exhausted, and maybe they would go back to Mecca without fighting. Then there is no need to fight. Prophet ﷺ didn't like to fight. And then Prophet ﷺ said, and if it happens that they attack Medina, then we fight them at the mouth of lens, of the lens of Al-Madina, and also Muslim women will help from the roofs of the houses, because the number of Muslims was very small, so they needed also women to help from the roof of the houses, maybe by throwing things on the disbelievers, hindering them from proceeding different ways. And they are safe, they are at the roof of their houses, so they are safe. And Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Abi Samur, the head of the hypocrites, he agreed to this opinion of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. He didn't agree because he knew that this was the best opinion, but he agreed just because his intention was not to fight with Muslims, so this was safer for him, not to be noticed by anybody, because everybody is inside Medina. So he was just inside Medina. If they go out, then everybody will know that he is still inside Medina, so he is a hypocrite. But Allah exposed him and the Munafiqeen in the same battle as well, as we will know, inshallah, maybe next time, inshallah. But some of the honorable and courageous, and all of the companions are honorable and courageous, of course, some of the honorable and courageous young men amongst the companions who were sitting in this assembly with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and who didn't join Badr, they were very keen to go outside Medina, because they thought that this is a big honor to go and to fight the enemy, you know, face to face, and not to let the enemy think that they are afraid of the disbelievers, and so on. And they said, and they kept on urging Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to fight outside Medina. The Prophet's opinion was to be inside Medina, and he saw the Ru'ya, and the Ru'ya told that it was better to be inside Medina. But the agent kept on urging the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of them stood up and said, Ya Rasulullah, kunna natamanna hadha al-yawma wa nad'u Allah. O Messenger of Allah, we were always longing for a day like this and making dua, O Allah, give us the chance to fight, you know, youths, to fight the disbelievers. Not to fight for sake of fighting, but to defend Islam and to defend Muslims. So they thought that, of course, it is a big honor, but still Prophet Muhammad said, لَا تَتَمَنَّوْا لِقَاءَ الْعَدُوِ وَلَكِنْ إِذَا لَقِيْتُمُوهُ فَاسْبُتُوا أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ Prophet Muhammad said, don't long for meeting with the enemy. But if you have already met with the enemy, then be firm. So those companions at that time, maybe they didn't understand this, and this was the beginning of Islam as well. And their intention was very good to defend Islam. They said, فَقَدْ سَاقَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْنَا وَقَرَّبَ الْمَسِيرِ So now it's the time to do it, to fight. And وَقَرَّبَ الْمَسِيرِ Now they are just outside Medina. We don't need to go for far. So now we don't have any excuse. They are speaking to whom? To the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is very patient, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, he knows more than anybody else. But he is very patient. He was very patient with them. And he just kept listening to them. They were young men. And you have to listen to young men as well. Because if we don't listen to young men, and this is one of the lessons that we can take as well. If we don't listen to young men, then they will not follow our advice. And they will go and to do more other harmful things, maybe. But if we listen to them and try to calm them down as much as we can, but then don't leave them alone. Then they said, أخرج إلى أعدائنا لا يرون أن جبلنا عنهم. You have to go out to meet the enemy outside Medina, lest they should think that we have lost our hearts and we are afraid of them. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, just kept listening. And he tried to convince them that it is very dangerous to fight outside Medina. We are maybe, you know, a very small number of Muslim warriors in front of 3,000 disbelieving warriors. But then, what has happened? Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, one of the uncles of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was also at that time a young man. Though he joined the Battle of Badr, he got the honor of joining the Battle of Badr, but he was very keen to fight outside Al-Madinah as well. He was with those youths. So, and he was even the head of those who were eager to urge the Prophet more and more to fight outside Al-Madinah. And he, the Prophet's uncle, and he is Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, his position was a big position in Mecca and among the small Muslims as well. So he said a very big thing to the Prophet ﷺ. He said to the Prophet ﷺ, وَالَّذِي أَنْزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ لَا أَطْعَمُ طَعَامًا حَتَّى أُجَالِدَهُمْ بِسَيْفِي خَارِجَ الْمَدِينَةِ He said to the Prophet ﷺ, by he who has sent down the Quran to you, I will never eat anything until I fight them with my sword outside Medina. So he blocked all the ways because he said it very clearly that no way, it must be outside Medina. So he, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of course, you know, I think that he desired to, you know, to prevent a fitna, you know, because now this is a big number of the youth and they Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sought their opinion in the Shura and they said so, and this was against his own opinion sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he knew that his opinion was better than theirs, but at the same time this what was said by them and unity of Muslims is a very important thing as well. So Prophet, of course, he desired to keep the unity of Muslims, and he maybe he knew that they were not to understand his viewpoint. They were very enthusiastic. Their intention was good. They were the, among the leading Muslims. So Prophet Muhammad accepted their opinion. And this is a lesson in the freedom of speech. So Islam is giving, you know, pioneered examples in the freedom of speech. He is the Prophet, the Messenger, and the President of the state, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he allowed young men to speak to him like this. And then he followed their opinion, though it was against his own opinion, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Is it time for Isha, Naam Salah?
No, I'm not.
Isa? Fine. Then Prophet Muhammad Sallam, this was the Jumu'ah as well. So Prophet Muhammad Sallam led Jumu'ah prayer, and in the sermon, he Sallam encouraged the Muslims to fight courageously, because fighting was inevitable at that time. And he told Muslims that if they would remain steadfast and patient, then Allah would grant them His support and victory. So this was said like this, very clear. If they would remain steadfast and patient, Allah would grant them His support and victory. Then Prophet Muhammad led Asr prayer. Asr time came and he led Asr prayer. Then he entered his home, one of his homes, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq and Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab went with him, and he got prepared by putting on the cloth of war and the head cloth of war, and he put on two armors, one over the other, and he wore his sword as well. And at that time, while Prophet was doing so, Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Sayyidina Usayd ibn Hudayr, they are chiefs of the Ansar, some of the chiefs of the Ansar, they started speaking to the youth who disagreed with the Prophet Muhammad. And they told them, استكرهتم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على الخروج فردوا الأمر إليه. They told them, you have forced Prophet Muhammad to fight outside Al-Madinah. So just tell him that all the affairs is left to him, and that the decision is his, and that you are going to be with him wherever he is, whether inside Medina or outside Medina. So when Prophet Muhammad went out his home, they said to him, now the youth understood, you know, after, you know, this you know, top of their you know, desire, they started to understand that it's better just to follow the Prophet, because he knows more than us. So they told him, Ya Rasulullah, ma kana lana an nukhalifak, O Messenger of Allah, we should have not disagreed with you. Fasna ma shi'at. So do whatever you like to do, O Messenger of Allah. إن أحببت أن تمكث بالمدينة فافعل. If you like to fight from inside Al-Madinah, then do so, and we are with you. We are happy to be inside Al-Madinah. But then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم gave humanity and gave us a lesson. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم, ما ينبغي لنبي إذا لبس لأمته وهي الدرع أن يضعها حتى يحكم الله بينه وبين عدوه. Prophet told them, it does not suit a prophet that after putting on the cloth of war, the armor and the cloth of war, that he takes this off until Allah has decided between him and his enemy. So he told them, no, I'm not going back, you know, I'm not going to take off the war cloth after I have put them on. If I have taken a decision, if a leader or if anyone has taken a decision, then he has to carry on. Because in the Quran, and I will conclude by this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ فإذا عزمت فتوكل على الله إن الله يحب المتوكلين. Consult them in the affair, and then if you have reached a decision, then put your trust in Allah and go on and carry on, act on the decision that you have taken. إن الله يحب المتوكلين. For verily Allah loves those who put their trust in Him. Because for a leader, after Ashura is done and a decision is taken, then it should be carried out. There is no way to go back and to change his mind like this. This is not, does not suit a prophet, and this is not the correct ruling on Shura. So may Allah, and you know, like when we make istikhara, for example, it's similar to this as well. You, if you, can I go to this job or not? Then you consult whoever has experience and get advice, their advice, and make dua, oh Allah, guide me. And then when you reach an opinion, then you make istikhara. You say, you know the dua of istikhara. If this is really good for me, then oh Allah, make it easy for me. Then after istikhara, halas, go on, carry out. If you have made istikhara, oh Allah, if it is good for me, then give it to me. Then after istikhara, go. Go and apply, or go to the interview, or go to the job. Take the job. Don't go back. You have already made istikhara. Then, if for something out of your own hands, you are, there is, you know, you can't proceed, then it's okay. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you can't proceed, then you proceed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, grant us the true understanding of the seerah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallam, and the, his obedience subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to follow the example of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I'm going to make short dua inshallah. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، واجعل تفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا ولا حولنا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم لا تدع لنا في ليلتنا هذه ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا تائبا إلا قبلت توبته، ولا مستغفرا إلا غفرت له، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا طالب علم إلا نجحته ووفقته. اللهم وفق أبناءنا وأبناء المسلمين والمسلمات لما فيه خيرهم ورشادهم يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم ولا تدع لنا في ليلتنا هذه حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها ويسرتها يا أرحم الراحمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وجزاكم الله خيرا، بارك الله فيكم، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله. See you next Tuesday إن شاء الله after Maghrib prayer إن شاء الله. بارك الله فيكم.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليماً.